cracks, rips, leaks, and deck gear bent out of shape, our fleet have a narrow window in the weather to put everything right. Welcome to the Ocean Race Show. Now, since the scoring gate was crossed 2 days ago, there has been so much happening out in the fleet as our boats creak under the strain of being locked together in a tight battle with sailors unable to ease off the pace. One thing is clear, the jobs list is growing. We need to go all the way back to the scoring gate on Sunday evening. And after the head-to-head fight to the line between Team Elitzia and 11th Hour Racing Team, each boat could finally assess things and build a plan for the next 7,000 miles. For 11th Hour Racing Team, their mainsail ripped while putting in a reef, the frustration of the moment keenly felt by everyone as their progress in the race was damaged again.
Full main downwind, and we went to take reef one, and basically on the front of the sail for reef one, we have a downline, so you pull it through with the winch to take tension on the front. And basically when we took tension on the front, the whole panel, so there's like a reinforced panel in the sail, so the load is ripped off. So effectively the front structural part of reef one is ripped off completely. So we dropped the main moor to reef two, about half the size of a full mainsail, but obviously now we can't use rip line and we can't use full main because of the rip, so don't really know what to do. It's quite a hard one to repair on board, nearly impossible I think, because of where it is. It's in a structural part of the sail, so all we have on board really is stuff to glue patches, which is fine, but in terms of having to take structural load, it's not really up to the job, so I don't know.
Let's not forget that this is on the back of them finding cracks in their rudders, all the problems that we've seen with the sails, and now a big tear in the structural part of their mainsail. This is really tricky, and in situations like this, responsibility falls, as always, to the skipper to show leadership and to mentally get the team back in the right frame of mind, thinking the right thoughts, and staying in that racing mode as much as possible. This is where Charlie Enright had to choose his words very carefully to get his team to the right place.
On a bare way. But obviously this is going to be our only time, conceivably, in the next couple days in moderate conditions to check well. We got points. I don't think we should take that lightly, but obviously we wanted more. And for me, as I've been thinking about it, like, the line is super clear. There's safety, and then there's everything else.
Yeah.
So like, if something's a pain in the ass, if it's inconvenient, if it's hard, anything other than impossible, I think we just forge on.
Yeah.
Not only because it's the most competitive thing we can do for this leg, getting the boat to Brazil as soon as possible is the most competitive thing we can do for the next leg.
Yeah, the rudder, I think we should take the pictures the same. I know we have the marker, but we should take it with the tape measure.
Yeah.
Structural checks. Bow, everything.
Yeah.
Foil cases, including down lines. You know, fins list. But then I think other things we can discuss that we should discuss underway are the rudder repair for the spare, are the mainsail repair for the spare, timing on that, expectation, so on the same page and not just like asking, hey, why haven't we done this yet, or, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Alright, so let's start with the job.
We'll do the rudder, and then we can always wallow on the other one.
Yeah, exactly. This is the only thing we need to do. It's this job specific.
Now they all had a plan of action, it was straight into ticking things off the list. First, the port rudder, which had shown signs of cracking at the root, was checked. Jack had marked the cracks to be able to gauge if they got worse, and luckily, it was good news.
That was okay now?
Yeah, okay.
With the crack not getting any worse, they jibed onto the other rudder to check their spare, to make sure the gremlins hadn't crept into this new one. Some good news after some bad, and it was at this point that 11th Hour Racing Team, along with the whole fleet, started checking over the boats from top to tail. The forecast had opened a window of lighter winds, but the sea state remained large, making progress around the boats slow, whether that was dragging sails back to the stern or working on the foredeck checking the gear. The inspection continued throughout the day, and as the sun set, Biotherm were getting ready to deal with a serious problem. A 3-meter crack had appeared in their starboard side longitudinal structure. Skipper Paul Mayer had to crawl down to the aft section of the boat to get access to the crack, marking the damaged parts before sanding them back smooth for the repair. Once the surface was ready, the new carbon layers were rolled out and glue applied, all of this being done in the dark, cramped section of the boat. The repair was smoothed flat and the bubbles worked through with a roller. Hopefully, everything good for the next 7,000 miles.
À part aller shooter à l'acétone et à la résine.
Moi, je dirais 2 heures.
Le ski a été long, c'était le ponçage.
Getting enough heat to cure the resin was a challenge. Rerouting the heat from the engine wasn't quite enough, so they settled on a method that most of us would not choose. Do not do this at home. I am far from convinced that this is the best way to get heat into the system to get the resin to cure, even if you are down there in these freezing temperatures. They seem to know what they're doing, but at this point, I have to be absolutely clear, I would not recommend this as a method if you are repairing your own boat. This wasn't the only issue with the boat. It was clear to see that their port side pulpit stanchions were bent outboard, but still holding the guard wires at least. And Biotherm was not the only boat with bent stanchions. Team Malizia had the same, although only slightly bent inwards, while 11th Hour Racing Team had their pulpit bent too. All of the stanchions on the IMOCAs are made of stainless steel, and they have to be. And I guess that's far smarter to use a material that if it does bend, you can bend it back, rather than making something stronger but stiff, where carbon would just snap under load. So who knows how many of these stanchions in the race so far have been bent and then re-bent back into shape. However, for these three boats, the stanchions are now aligned and it was on with finding things for the job list. Watching the sailors meticulously check all over every aspect of their boat, patiently, diligently, it reminds us of how reliant they are on the boat, not just for the race, but for living on the sea.
Three times, three torque. The spare wand was just sitting in the bilge. All the stuff that was lashed was completely mangled. But the good news is all the structure's good. Four valves and 3/4 full. A and C are airtight. Did you do the foil cases?
Foils are good, keels are okay. Walk on. See enough to say more.
Yeah.
While they're all talking, Justine is desperate to get this boat back up to full speed. She does not do slow sailing. She's a solo IMOCA sailor herself. But of course, you've got to remember that she's back in the ocean race for another victory. She won the race in the last edition on board Dongfeng Race Team. And the navigator for that team, Pascal Bedigeri, thinks that having her on board any team is a very wise decision.
The better way be able to sail in IMOCA today in crew is to have sailed alone before, you know. I think this is a very good thing. During 24 hours, you have the same level, you know, but a very high level. So you don't have a very big peak, so you don't have 120% and sometimes 60. But all the time, you are something around 90, and this is a very good way to be able to be a good sailor in offshore racing and for a very, very long leg for like this one.
For now on board 11th Hour Racing Team, the mainsail doesn't seem to be an easy or quick fix. So they've set the boat up with two reefs, only using the part of the sail above the tear and keeping the damaged section folded away against the boom.
We gotta remember as a group that we're here kind of engaging in one of life's last great adventures, and we're doing it together as a squad, and we need to enjoy it, and certainly enjoy each other's company. It's been a lot of hard work just to get to this point. Put a lot of hard hours into the boat too, and we got to get this boat to Brazil. That's the big goal from here.
Brazil is the goal, but it's not a straight route. They have to stay north of the ice safety line, a do not cross barrier around the bottom of the world that race control keeps updating. And they've just moved the line based on the latest ice forecast.
our old limit was somewhere through here, and in the recent scans, because they're always sort of scanning the course ahead of us, in order that we can have the most open race course we can, but we're as safe as possible. And they detected an iceberg in this region here. And then generally, they drift to the east or the northeast. And then when they hit the warmer water, they tend to break up or fragment, and that's when you get lots of bergy bits that actually probably present the biggest risk to us as a fleet. Obviously, in these groups. You okay?
Yeah.
Are you much down?
I thought it was an iceberg. Yeah. Oh, now we lost the
mic. Now we lost the screen. Yeah. Oh, we're back on.
With everything that these sailors have been going through, it's amazing to see them find those moments just to laugh again and get themselves back to enjoying this adventure. And there are lots of reasons why. I mean, one of them is that they're professional athletes and they've trained through the psychology of dealing with these kinds of things for the last 20, 30 years. But there's also some very small things, and I thought it'd be interesting to point one of them out. This is another shot of the cockpit, and you can see here what looks to be maybe a red light, maybe a red button on the bulkhead. And I think that this is actually their reset button. I've heard this talked about before. And if it is that reset button, it's nothing more than just half a tennis ball coloured red mounted onto the bulkhead. And the team psychologist is keen to get them to go through not only that mental process of agreeing that, okay, I'm going to move on, I'm no longer going to get frustrated by this, but turning that into a physical action as well, pressing that button. Your whole body, your mind as well. Right, today is a new day and I've got to move on. I've got to get those good thoughts back into my mind. It's a really small thing, but it makes a big difference. While all this has been going on since crossing the scoring gate, the three boats behind are still closing down with Team Wholesome PRB. Out in first, Kevin Escoffier knew he needed to do something to hold the lead. So they traded miles ahead to miles south, skirting the ice limit and sailing the shortest distance possible. Multiple jibes were needed to stay to the south, and the rest of the fleet followed when they could, with Team Malizia in second but further north, and Biotherm in third, with 11th Hour Racing Team behind in fourth. The question for Team Wholesome PRB is, how long will that lead stay? Does the situation for the next few days favour them or the boats behind?
For 1 week, there was a forecast that's not very good for us. But that's it. We take it like that, and we will see in the next miles. We have close to 2 weeks to go to Cape Horn. So we had sometimes strong wind, but not something unbelievable. And it was always okay to sail. And we will see in 1 week, it could be difficult.
Tom on board Team Wholesome PRB seems to be taking it all in his stride. And perhaps that's because this boat seems to be largely unscathed from the conditions so far on this leg, the only boat to do so. They just haven't yet faced any major problems on board. But for Pascal Bedigeri, who trained with the team leading up to this race, he's not surprised about that.
They work a lot with all the team about be able to have a boat, a safety boat, to something is quite okay now. You can push and you are not breaking everything. So we try to push a lot during all the training. So we was not doing training, cool training. We was doing strong training, big sea stays and everything, big win, and to be able to break all what was possible during the race. And I'm sure today Kevin is really focused to be able, because I know she's really focused about performance. He knows that he had to ride first in Tajai, so when you look at how they manage the performance of the boat, and I think it's a bit the same for all the fleet. Today, they know what they have to put on the top of the list. And the top of the list is to be able to go to Itanjai. So the story is really not finished.
A strong boat forging ahead in these conditions. But what have we learned so far? Well, we know that the boats are going over their limits. The sailors regularly push them beyond what we could probably expect from certainly a weekend sailor in the pursuit of speed and the performance edge. And this is going to continue over the next 7,000, 6,000 miles as we head towards Cape Horn and then up to Brazil. In the past, this race has seen a lot of drama in this part of the world. For now, for our teams, hopefully the worst is behind them. done.